Gentlemen, the new office chairs are here.
Three, two, one. It's time we solve this problem the old-fashioned way. By shooting it.
Wait. You can't give everybody guns. What if one of us is the creature? It could be any of us. Fry, Leela, Amy, Zoidberg.
One of us must be the bad creature. Is it me, maybe? Oh.
Now, we just reintroduce Calculon's programming to his body using science.
It's like magic, but with electricity.
First, we put on our protective suits. Then, place the body equidistant from the five nearest wireless network hubs.
This is the least scientific thing I've ever seen.
You be quiet. Now, it's a simple matter of reverse installing Calculon's operating system. Amy, play this installation disc backwards.
Rise from the dead in the name of Satan.
Ah, these guys.
Oh my.
Wild human!
They ship it!
Whee!
You know, I'm feeling a little...
I'm dead! I'm gonna die!
Hermes! Boy, am I indifferent to see you!
We need to talk. Alone.
Okay, Hermes. Sure.
Fry!
Could you come in here and help me rub on this new scented body oil?
In a second. I'm eavesdropping.
Please, Fry. Leela punishes me when I don't use enough.
I said not now. Neck. Tap. Tap. Climb. Climb. And we're back in business.
Welcome to the abyss.
Well, it could be worse. It is worse!
Them to bake a bitch with a well-placed warning shot.
But
we've had some tough times, but at least we won a Tony.
You won a Tony.
That's all you get, jerks.
Puny humans, tremble in fear and put your hands together for Morbo's good friend and mortal enemy, Chris Hardwick!
Welcome! Good news, everyone. Futurama cannot be killed. It is back in game form. Worlds of Tomorrow comes out June 29th. And we're super excited to be able to present this event. As you can see, there's a lot of names right there that are very special. My wife and I, when we first started dating, we used to watch Futurama episodes every night, even though we had seen them all 100 times. And so this is really special for us, too. The only cast note that I'll say is Katie could not be here. Not because she doesn't like any of you, she just couldn't, okay? So just let it go. But the entire cast is going to be here. Tress is going to be reading for Katie. And that's it. There'll be surprises, fun. We'll do a Q&A afterwards. So if you have some questions, we'll have about 15 minutes for that. And let's just get this going. Here we go. The voice of Bender Bending Rodriguez, John DiMaggio.
Hello, you people.
Oh, he's mad. As Amy Lauren Tom. As Kip and Morbo, Maurice LaMarche!
Yes!
As Hermes and Preacher Bot, Phil LaMarche! The voice of Mom, Aunt Hattie, and also filling in today for Leela, Tress McNeil. And as Scruffy Dave Herman. Is Fry Farnsworth Zoidberg. Please welcome Billy West!
Find your life, Bill. Find your life.
And then his exec... You made it a competition. That's really funny. And head writer, executive producer extraordinaire, David X. Cohen!
Yeah! Hello!
And then also, as a special surprise guest here to encourage and or threaten the cast members, please welcome a guy that you may have heard of by the name of Matt Groening!
Thank you. All I can say is this better be good.
He's never seen this episode.
So help me, I'll make you make new episodes of Futurama. Oh! Ladies and gentlemen, the soul of Futurama, David X. Cohen.
I believe I have my own mic. Secondhand, Mike. Welcome, everybody, and a special welcome to all the Futurama fans watching online and through the windows. Thank you for watching tonight. We are about to do a live table reading of a classic episode in honor of the new Futurama game, Futurama Worlds of Tomorrow, which will be out June 29th for all your favorite devices. And before we start, I just wanted to thank a few people, Tiny Co., Jam City, and Fox, for working so hard to make this game very true to the series. This is really the real deal here. As you see, they have reassembled from spare body parts the entire original cast of the series, including even also Katie Sagal and Frank Welker, who plays Nibbler, who are not here this evening, but they are in the game. Also some celebrity heads in jars. I won't give you any spoilers, but I will say, oh my. They've got our original animators at the groundbreaking studio Rough Draft Studios working the animation. And they've put together a team of original writers from the show, including Patrick Verone, Ken Keeler, and David X. Cohen, don't forget that. So this is really some hardcore Futurama, and it's very exciting to be here tonight for this table read. And lastly, for anyone who does not know what a table read is, you should have just paid more attention to the name Table Read. It's pretty much all in there. That's all you need to know. Let's do it. This is a classic episode, episode 6ACV04. It's entitled Proposition Infinity. It was written by Mike Rose.
Where's Mike?
Stand up for crying out loud.
Stand up, there's Mike.
In the house.
It was directed by the awesome Crystal Chesney Thompson from Rough Draft Studios. Original air date, July 8th, 2010, so we're even a little bit into the future from the original air date of this show. And here we go, we fade in Amy's apartment in the afternoon. We go inside her luxuriously furnished apartment to see Amy and Kiff watching TV. On the screen, we see the channel Square Root of 2 news set. Newscasters Linda and Morbo are reporting the news.
We now go live to our Eye in the Sky hovercopter on the scene of that terrible hovercopter crash. Jim?
We cut to a video feed of a crashed, burning newscopter. The reporter Jim is strapped upside down, speaking through the flaming window.
The news is not good. I just learned that my final words were, back to you, Linda.
The copter explodes. The picture goes to static, then Linda reappears.
One for the blooper reel.
Back to scene, Kiff cringes in horror and covers his eyes.
Ooh, the news is so violent. Let's watch Dancing with the Stars instead. No, wait, there might be trash talk.
God, what a wuss. Stop being such a spineless jellyfish.
You know full well I am more closely related to the sea cucumber.
Not where it counts.
Whoa. Kiff looks hurt. His whole body shrivels slightly. On the news set, an image on the news shows Jim upside down in the copter with the caption, Jim, 2968 to 3010.
I hated Jim.
The image changes to show a new image of a tile mural that mysteriously resembles Bender's face.
In other news, our city's filthy urine-soaked walls have been desecrated by a mysterious tilework graffiti artist.
Police have no leads as to who's behind this innovative scourge of public art.
We match dissolve to a close-up of Bender's face. Widen to see the Brooklyn Bridge. Sneaky music plays as Bender descends on a cable. He looks around cautiously, then with rapid riveter-like hand movements, he affixes more tiles and admires his likeness.
That is one sexy bridge abutment.
We go to a montage. Bender's putting up murals everywhere. He puts up one on a hover bus stop enclosure, surprising Mayor Poopenmeyer.
Somebody stop that talented vandal!
We see an Obama Hope-style poster of Nixon with the one-word motto, despair. Bender tiles a mural over it as the Nixon image protests. Cut to a highway sign that reads, Freeway Ends at Corner. Bender puts up a mural that partly obscures it, so it now reads, Free Corn. Cut to see thy hyper-chicken lawyer driving by.
Free corn? Well, that suits me just fine.
He floors it, his car races off screen. We hear a brake screech, then a huge crash. Car parts, feathers, and Hyper Chicken's bow tie fly by. Cut to later, 2 a.m., Bender's sneaking along, putting up more murals.
The key is knowing precisely where to strike.
He plasters a mural off camera. We widen to reveal it's on police robot Earl's ass. His partner, Smitty, stands nearby.
Oops!
Well, well. Time to beat him his rights.
Smitty and Earl beat Bender with their lightsaber clubs. As the beating continues, Smitty glances at the mural.
You know, that don't look half bad on your buttocks.
It does sort of class up the place.
Cut to the skyline late at night. The city is silent and dark as we pan to a digital clock tower. It strikes 4 a.m. with a quiet ding. Then a voice booms from a huge speaker.
The time is 4 a.m.
In Amy's living room, Amy sits on the couch, bleary, head in hands. Kiff paces.
We've been arguing all night, Kiff. Can't we just go to bed?
Is that all you ever think about? I'm not just some piece of tofu, Amy. I need to know where we stand in our relationship.
We're just going through a rough patch.
It is not a patch. It's been ages, according to your wildly inappropriate hunk of the month calendar.
He gestures, gestures to a calendar featuring the sexy Todd, a shirtless muscle man with a fireman's hat holding a saxophone.
Leave Todd out of this.
The image of Todd speaks.
Thanks, babe. Also, today is June 20th, the summer solstice.
We updated the script a little bit for today's reading. Todd plays a wolf whistle riff on his saxophone.
Ooh.
Suddenly, Amy's video phone starts flashing and ringing.
That's Bender's ringtone. I recognize his smell.
Amy picks up an old 1970s handset from the video phone. Bender, in a jail cell, appears on the screen.
Hello?
Yo, Amy, I'm in the slammer.
Oh, no!
That's enough lip out of you, moneybag. Just get $5,000 to bail me out.
I don't have that kind of money laying around.
Yeah, you do. You know that floor safe where you keep $10,000? There's $5,000 in there. Don't make me wait.
Cut to the jail. A sign reads, Will Riker's Island. Smaller print reads, Try Our Toilet Wine. Inside, Bender's in a holding cell with a bunch of mean-looking human and robot criminals, including Roberto.
Hey, Bender. You ever kill a man with a suck? It ain't so hard. Ha! Ha! Ha!
I better carve a shiv for protection.
Bender pulls a wooden stick from his chest, followed by a large switchblade. He starts carving the stick into a very similar-looking knife. Meanwhile, Earl steps up to the cell along with Kiff and Amy.
Rodriguez, these two brothers bailed your ass out.
He unlocks the door. Bender steps out and hugs Kiff. Kiff's head briefly expands like a squeezy toy.
Oh, thank God I'm free. Tell me, have things changed on the outside? Is food finally in pill form? What about pills? Are they in food form?
Cut to Amy. We see a scary-looking prisoner leering at her through the bars.
Hey, hot stuff. I'm Larry, the murder burglar.
Hi, Larry. I like your tattoos.
Kif tries to pull Amy away.
Amy, this man is a criminal.
I'm just checking out his tats.
She leans over to look at Larry's forearm. We see he has a video tattoo in needlepoint style of a house that reads Home Sweet Home. In the tattoo, Larry jumps out a window holding a television. He turns and throws a Molotov cocktail back into the house. It explodes and flames shoot out the windows.
Oh, Sneedo! I have a tattoo of my mom. Wanna see?
Sure.
Amy starts to pull down her pants. Cut to the jail clerk's window. A little later, Bender's retrieving his belongings from the clerk.
One pimp hat, one ass-polishing chamois, and one trombone engraved property of Hattie.
Yeah, that's mine.
Kip and Amy stand nearby.
I just don't get why you have to flirt with every bad boy in sight.
Ugh, quit exaggerating.
Smitty and Earl escort Roberto past Amy. He suddenly breaks free, grabs Amy, and holds a sock to her temple.
Nobody move, or Sweet Cheeks here gets a sock between the eyes.
Oh, you're bad.
Oh,
Earl applies a Vulcan neck pinch to Roberto. He falls to the floor in a heap.
Mama said, Spock you out.
That's it, Amy. Pardon my language, but I've had it with you ruffling my petticoats. You and I are through.
Kif storms out through a door. Sad music plays as we slowly push in on Amy, looking heartbroken.
Here's a little song I wrote to cheer you up. It's called Let's Go Already!
Bender blasts her in the face with a loud trombone blast. We cut to Forbidden Planet Hollywood restaurant. Sign reads, Where Tourists Come to Mingle with Tourists. Inside, it's a Hollywood-themed restaurant filled with memorabilia. Bender gazes into a case containing Chewbacca's feet. We pan past other cases displaying Iron Man's underpants, Elvis's pelvis, and Calculon's agent. In the booth, Leela, Amy, Bender, and Fry are having martinis. Each holds an empty glass with a tiny rain cloud over it. Leela raises hers in a toast.
Here's to Amy, single, lonely, and fabulous.
She clinks glasses with Amy. Upon clinking, there's a tiny thunderburst, and the martini rain begins filling the glasses.
Thanks, everybody. Looks like I'm back in the game.
Yeah, the game of old maid.
Hostess. The hostess approaches Bender.
Excuse me, sir. Are those yours?
She points down and we see Bender's wearing the Chewbacca feet in place of his normal feet.
Damn right. Before you ask, this is mine too.
He opens his chest, revealing a scared-looking lassie's head in a jar. He slams the door shut.
So, Amy, tough break. Are you and Kif getting divorced?
No. Technically, we were fanfan ruse, so we weren't really married.
Wow, that is really interesting. You know the most interesting thing about that is...
So, Amy, how can I phrase this delicately? Why did Kif dump you like a sack of yesterday's turds?
He says I have a thing for bad boys. It's so stupid.
The truth is often stupid.
Bender puffs some cigar smoke in Amy's face. And taps the ashes into Amy's drink as she coughs.
Bender, why do you have to be so mean to me?
Shut up, baby. You love it.
Don't tell me to shut up. You know what happened to the last guy who told me to shut up.
What?
Smash cut to Amy's bedroom the next morning. Amy and Bender are lying in bed under the sheets. Relax.
Of course.
That was great.
Shut up.
They snuggle and kiss.
Oh, yeah. Come on over here, baby. Give me some of that. Oh, yeah.
As we fade out, Act 2, New York. The next morning, we see commuters flying to work in the transparent tubes. In a closer shot, Bender and Amy are commuting together. Amy's hurriedly doing her hair.
Remember, love between a human and robot is taboo. We can't tell anyone, not even our co-workers.
Got it. I'll show the utmost discretion as we get nasty in this glass tube.
They start making out once again. A little later, in the Planet Express conference room, the crew members are seated around the table. Zoidberg peers closely at Bender.
Bender, old friend.
What's on your face?
We see a lipstick kiss mark on Bender's cheek. Bender quickly wipes it away.
Blood! From, you know, shaving of the beard face!
Amy, are those gear imprints on your sweatpants?
Maybe. So what?
I only brought it up because Bender's wearing them.
You see, Bender is wearing Amy's pink sweatpants. Bender's eyes dart nervously.
I stole them from her. Yeah, that's it. Call the cops.
That night, out on the street, Bender and Amy happily hold hands as they walk down a mostly empty street.
Amy, I reckon sweet talk don't come natural to me, but of everyone I've ever dated, you are probably in the top 10.
Aw, you always say just the wrong thing in just the right way.
They kiss.
Sinners!
We widen to reveal Preacher Bot standing beside a donations bucket watching scornfully.
Robosexuality is an abomination!
Boy, this guy.
The good book saith a robot shall not lie down with a human, nor do it standing up, nor in any angle in between.
Amy edges behind Bender, embarrassed. A mob of people, aliens, and robots gather around.
It's a what you call it, and a Chinese girl.
Sweet clown, laugh derisively at them.
Ha! 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 Ha!
What are we gonna do?
I'll distract them. Look, behind you! It's a single mother! Get her!
The angry mob turns away furiously. Amy and Bender smile at each other and sneak off in the other direction. Cut to outer space the next day. We see an alien planet with a swirling atmosphere. A Chiron reads, Planet Tornadus. The planet express ship swoops toward it. On the surface of Tornadus, several huge tornadoes sweep across the plains. The ship flies into frame and weaves among them.
Quickly, into the ship's basement.
Cut into the ship's basement. The ship's low, never-before-seen bottom deck with wooden beams, an old washer and dryer, cobwebs, and old high basement windows. Zoidberg closes the overhead cellar doors. Bender and Amy steal a sly glance.
And now then, as you all know, the county fair is approaching once again. So I'm preparing my entry of pickled winds and feathers.
He indicates a line of jars on a shelf. We pan to each one containing a miniature weather system in brine, as it is described.
I've got sunny, snow flurries, hail with onions, even my grandmother's cranberry raisin typhoon.
We see cranberries and raisins whirling around in a tiny storm.
But no tornado. I'll be damned if I let Mrs. Girdleson take the blue ribbon again.
The professor pulls a cord, causing flowered curtains to retract. A frightening tornado is visible just through the violently rattling window. A red barn blows by with Bender's tile graffiti on it.
That's why I need you folks to get out there and harvest a nice ripe one. This cattle prod should help.
He holds up a cattle prod.
I don't see how that's gonna...
He jabs Hermes with the cattle prod.
No! Get out there!
Cut to the planet's surface a little later. The crew members hover in jetpacks around a huge tornado, aiming laser guns at it. They yell over the howling wind.
Is everybody in position?
What?
Is someone talking?
Okay, good. On three. One.
What did she say?
Two.
Wait, I'm not in position.
Three.
I'm ready for the countdown.
I'm not hearing anyone. Abort mission.
She said go.
They all fire their lasers wildly in all directions as they're swept in and out of the storm. Cut back to inside the basement a little later.
Good work, everyone.
See the crew members, except Bender and Amy, standing in the regular part of the ship now.
Honestly, that went better than I expected.
We reveal, the tornado's now safely shrunk down and contained in a 10-foot-high glass cylinder.
I just need to reduce it down into this pickle jar. Toss in a bay leaf to impress those stupid judges.
He turns a knob, the tornado starts to slow and becomes a little more translucent. A smaller tornado begins to materialize in his mason jar on top of his apparatus. Meanwhile, Fry looks around.
Hey, where's Amy and Bender?
They're missing out on some hot pickle action.
Angle on the tornado. We hear whipping winds combined with strange moaning sounds.
Sound like a muskrat.
congrats, Cordendale.
Professor slows the tornado a bit more. We see Amy's sweatshirt zip by.
Oh, that's Amy's sweatshirt.
Now we see Bender's pimp hat going by.
And that's Bender's hat from the players' ball.
Sweet tornadoes of Barbados! Amy and Bender have been torn to shreds!
Suspenseful music plays as the tornado continues to slow. We see Amy's bra, then Bender's accordion go by.
Oh, the humanity! Also Bender!
As the tornado slows nearly to a stop, Bender and Amy are revealed in the slowly swirling naked embrace. The crew members stare in shock, but Bender and Amy don't notice. Suddenly, they drop to the floor, finally aware of the others.
What's going on here?
Nothing.
Cut back to the Earth in the Planet Express conference room. Amy and Bender stand together up front as the shock crew members sit around the table. The professor paces angrily.
A pair of deviant robosexuals? Not under my roof.
What about on the roof?
Get your mind out of the gutter.
What about in the gutter?
Professor, there's nothing wrong with robosexuality.
Yeah, when the lights go out, it's nobody's business what goes on between two consenting adults.
Or one.
Thanks, guys. Everything will be okay as long as my parents don't find out.
You see the professor just finishing a phone call.
Zaijian!
He hangs up. Suddenly, the doorbell rings. Fry opens the door, revealing Amy's parents, Inez and Leo Wang.
Mom? Dad?
Come home, Amy. It's your decision. We can't make you.
He lassos Amy and drags her out by the ankles.
Atta girl!
The door closes behind them. Angle on the professor. He hangs up the phone again.
Uh-oh! Not the innocent whistling!
The doorbell rings. Fry opens it, revealing Preacher Bot.
Repent!
Oi, this guy.
Preacher Bot ejects a magnet on a chain. It sticks to Bender's feet and drags him out. The doors close. Cut to the planet Mars. The Wong family ranch. We pan across the mountainous landscape to the ranch. A sign reads, "No broke backing." Inside, in their dining room, Inez, Leo, and Amy are sitting quietly at the dinner table.
Look, we are your family. And if you can't talk about your problem with us, that would be great. I don't have a problem. I'm in a happy relationship that just happens to be robosexual.
If you finish that word, you'll kill your parents.
So then a box-like robot waiter rolls in.
Low wine level detected.
It refills Amy's glass with a built-in spigot.
Thank you.
Leo jumps up between the robot and Amy.
Stop seducing him, you hussy.
Dad, please. I'm attracted to Bender, not this emotionless wine bucket.
A single tear rolls down the robot waiter's cheek.
Oh, hopes deleted.
Wow.
Meanwhile, at a religious camp, we see beautiful manicured campgrounds. A sign over the stone archway reads, "Camp Rectifier, praying on the week since 2976. Inside, Bender, Fatbot, and an effeminate male robot, along with the transvestite Hookerbot, sit in folding chairs facing Preacherbot.
Robotic brothers, the path to robot hell is paved with human flesh.
Me?
Over the course of this escape-proof workshop, your software will be reprogrammed through prayer and by some tech support guys and ninja.
The effeminate robot holds up a copy of Esquired magazine.
But I read in Esquired magazine that some robots are hardwired to be robosexual.
Don't believe those lies, son. The only lies worth believing are the ones in the Bible. Can I get an amen?
I take a three man. Holla!
Back on Amy's parents' front porch. The Amy is sitting on the porch looking annoyed. Inez and Leo stand beside her, facing a lineup of human men.
Oh, come on, Amy. Pick a male human already. I want to be a grandmother 9 months from 5 minutes from now. Oh, cut it out, Mom. I'm not interested in any of these gross, ugly losers.
Suddenly, Fry steps into the lineup and points to himself.
What about this gross, ugly, smelly loser? Fry, what you doing here? I'm here to rescue Amy, from her robosexual desires.
He winks at Amy.
Oh, if I understand you correctly, I've seen the error of my ways.
She winks back at Fry.
Look at all that awkward winking.
Yeah, must be love.
Moments later, the Planet Express ship shoots through space inside Leela's piloting. Fry has Amy standing right beside him.
My parents may be evil, but at least they're stupid.
Cut back to the campground. PreacherBot and the four robots are out in a field.
In this phase, you will literally wrestle with your demons. Your shapely, buxom, human demon.
He pulls a cloth off a rack of stuffed football tackle dummies designed to look like sexy human women.
Look at the rack on that one. I mean, that one on the rack.
PreacherBot blows a coach's whistle. He shouts over various shots of the robots wrestling, caressing, and making out with the dummies.
Yeah, good. That's real good.
I'm gonna rub on you.
PreacherBot mops his brow with a handkerchief.
No, okay. Everybody switch demons. No point in staying with just one demon.
There's a frantic scramble on the field.
Now, work it harder till the sin explodes out ya.
Cut to an extreme close-up of the PreacherBot.
Mercy. Okay. The Lord's work is done. Now cuddle with your demons.
On Bender, he hugs a slightly Amy-like dummy.
Oh, Amy, I wonder where you are right now.
I'm inside the dummy to rescue you.
Well, that answers that. Wait, Amy?
Mad with passion, Bender rides wildly with the dummy.
Oh, no.
Suddenly, we hear Fry and Leela's pained voices also from inside the suit.
Be careful.
Fry, Leela, you're in there too? Blech.
Then we hear yet another voice.
I guess we should have waited in the ship.
Cut back to Planet Express. The crew looks on as Amy and Bender kiss passionately.
Fui.
Listen up, everybody. I love Amy, and I'm tired of pussyfoot cupping around. I finally found someone I want to spend the rest of my life. Well, I finally found somebody I want to spend the rest of her life with.
He turns to Amy, a sincere expression on his face.
Amy?
Bender opens a small box with a diamond ring in it. A tag reads Exhibit A. His legs lower hydraulically to kneeling height.
Will you marry me?
Yes! Yes! Hooray!
Oh, I'm just glad I didn't live to see this day. Wait a second.
The professor feels his own wrist. Cut to a close-up. After a second, we see a very faint heartbeat, and there's a slight movement.
No!
That's a black. Act 3, close-up on the glistening diamond ring. Wanting to see, we're still in the conference room. The ring's now on Amy's finger. Zoidberg is admiring it.
Such a stone. Is it real?
Amy lifts Zoidberg's shirt and runs the gem across his shell in a circular motion. After a second, the circle falls out with a clatter, revealing his organs within.
Hooray! Hooray denied! May I remind you that robosexual marriage is illegal?
Not in space, Massachusetts.
You mean space, Taxachusetts? No chance, Stretch Pants. We're gonna fight to legalize it right here.
Yeah, man, you got to legalize it.
We're talking about robosexual marriage.
We're talking about lots of stuff.
Out on the street, the next day, a banner reads, Gear Witch Village Robosexual Pride Rally. Thumping electronic music plays over a garish block party for humans and robots with floats, wild costumes, homemade signs, and carefree dancing. On one float, we see Scruffy dancing with Wash Bucket. On Fry and Leela, they're standing beside a hot dog cart. Suddenly, the cart transforms into a towering robot.
Cool. Can you turn into a race car?
Nah, I'm just a pre-op transformer.
On the big central stage, Bender and Amy are hand in hand as they step up to the mic.
Thank you for coming, everyone. We're all having some good, clean fun here.
Ooh, squeaky, squishy clean.
Reveal hedonism bot in a studded leather outfit. The hot dog cart, now standing on two legs, pours a tub of pink hot dogs on top of him.
Ooh, yes. More mustard, John Bear.
But it's time to discuss a pressing issue. The right to marry who or what we want.
Every other couple has the right to marry.
We see the crowd.
Robot and fembot, man and woman, man and man.
As he speaks, we pan past a series of couples. The Donbot and Fanny, Michelle and Pauly Shore, Randy and his husband, and they're holding a fancily groomed little dog.
Our poodle has two daddies. Interracial.
We see a man who's black on the left side and white on the right with a woman of opposite coloration.
Interplanetary.
We see the upper half of a human woman protruding from a male gelatinous blob. They wave.
Even ghost and horse.
We see an unconcerned horse floating around in a cloud of ectoplasm.
But not robot and human.
The ghost joins in. Amy holds up a legal document titled Proposition Infinity.
That's why we're introducing this ballot initiative to legalize robosexual marriage.
Yeah! If you hate intolerance and being punched in the face by me, please support Proposition Infinity.
We go to a happy music montage. First, Amy pins a yes on Infinity button on a rubbery alien. The alien pops like a balloon. He deflates and flies off as his business suit droops to the ground. Next, we see Bender putting up an even more complex tile graffiti mural of himself and Amy kissing. It reads, Vote Infinity. Widen to see, it's once again on Earl's ass. Earl hits him in the head with his baton.
Ow!
Cut to Fry, Leela, and Zoidberg and Hermes standing on the sidewalk, holding a banner that reads, Stand Up for Equality. We pan to see the Professor, Hattie, and other elderly people lying on the concrete beside a banner that reads, Fall down and be unable to get up for traditional marriage. Widen to see this on the TV news in the Square to Two News studio. Linda and Morbo are reporting once again. A pie graph shows a large no section and only a small yes section.
As Election Day nears, Prop Infinity appears to doom to certain defeat.
Doom!
More fair and balanced coverage after a word from our sponsor, No on Infinity.
We cut to a commercial where scary, overly dramatic music covers a sharp shot of dark clouds. A sinister, concerned man fades into view.
A storm is gathering.
A second concerned man appears.
A storm of robosexual marriage that will rain down on us like fire.
It's probably a firestorm.
Now a concerned woman appears with two children at her sides.
If robosexual marriage becomes legal, imagine the horrible things that will happen to our children. Then imagine we said those things, since we couldn't think of any. As a mother, those things worry me.
Vote no on Infinity. Paid for by the Farnsworth Foundation.
A small print and a tiny logo of the professor's face. In Planet Express, the whole crew is watching this on TV.
We can't compete against that much stock footage of clouds. We're boned.
Ah, but we still have one hope. My big televised debate. I'm a master debater.
Aye, aye, aye.
Professor, who's debating for your side? Oh, that guy. You know who I mean. I forget his name.
Cut to several days later, the professor's at the lectern. He points to himself on a small monitor.
That's him.
Lying to see, we're in the debate hall. The professor's at one lectern, Bender's at the other. An audience, including the other crew members, looks on. At the moderator's table, we see George Takei's head in a jar.
Good evening. I'm George Takei's head and neck, your host for tonight's debate. You may applaud.
Yeah, move it along, Takei.
Very well. We flipped the coin before the debate, and Bender stole it. So we'll start with him.
On Bender, Chiron reads, Bender B. Rodriguez, pro infinity.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury. Oops, sorry, force of habit.
Romantic music starts as the camera slowly pushes in on him.
I support this proposition because I love a goopy, flesh and blood woman. And not surprisingly, she loves me.
Cut to a reaction shot of Amy in the audience, teary-eyed.
This is a simple matter of justice, which I'm not normally for. So please, vote yes. After all, our love isn't any different from yours. Except it's hotter, because I'm involved.
The audience applauds. Bender sips a glass of water. The professor thumbs through some of his note cards. On the moderator's table, Takei looks moved.
I haven't heard such an eloquent speech since Bill Shatner explained why he couldn't pay me back. Rebuttal, Professor?
On the professor, Chiron reads, Professor H. Farnsworth, anti-infinity. Professor points angrily at Bender.
Ew, this $4 coffee pot talks about love, but what he describes is perversion.
You wouldn't know perversion if it put clamps on your testicles. You're just jealous because you never know true love.
Oh, no. Back when I was full of piss and vinegar, and my bed wasn't.
We dissolve, too. Many years ago, a flashback in a park. The young professor skips slow motion through a field of flowers, arm in arm with a beautiful young woman.
I fell in love with the sweetest girl ever to skip through a field of posies. Her name was Eunice. And we spent our blissful days working in a lab, developing a poison to wipe out that dreadful posy infestation.
Cut to the lab. In the lab, the young professor holds a bouquet toward Eunice. She squeezes a drop of liquid onto it, and the flowers wilt and blacken. They kiss passionately.
I thought our love would last forever. But then, 43 years later...
The now middle-aged professor is holding a heart-shaped box of chocolates. He opens a door to see Eunice in bed with a robot. The box drops and cracks in half as the professor falls to his knees in horror.
She left me! For a robot!
Match dissolved back to the debate. The professor's crying at his lectern.
How could she do that to me? Her farny poo.
Amy rises and yells out angrily from the crowd.
That's it? You hate robosexuals because your girlfriend left you for a robot?
She didn't just leave me for a robot. She was a robot. Oh, God. Her name wasn't Eunice. It was Unit. Unit 47.
Dissolve back to the same flashback in the posy field. Once again, the professor and Eunice are skipping through the flowers in slow-mo, except gradually the image of Eunice dissolves into that of Unit 47, a bulky fembot. We hear the loud metallic clangs of her footsteps.
My heart was broken, and like a bitter old pickle puss, I took it out on robosexuals everywhere. I'm so ashamed.
Emotional music swells as we return to the lectern.
At the risk of losing this debate, I beg you, support Proposition Infinity! Yeah!
Give me a hug!
Bender hugs the professor.
I too am hugging them in spirit. And now they're hugging me back. Oh my.
In the Planet Express lounge, the following evening, the crew's gathered around the TV. On screen, Linda and Morbo are back at their desk.
In a stunning turnabout, voters have approved Proposition Infinity. Robosexual marriage is now legal.
What's next? Gay robosexual marriage?
Back to scene. Bender and Amy hug and kiss in victory.
Yay!
We did it, honey. Finally, we can have a legal, monogamous marriage like everyone else.
Woohoo! Yeah! Wait, monogamous?
Smash cut to a tropical beach. Bender relaxes on a beach chair between two sexy fembots. He sips a fruity drink as we push in on his portable radio.
And now, a long-distance dedication. From a squishy green bad boy to his pink pork dumpling.
Back at Planet Express in the lounge, Amy looks heartbroken. But then, we hear a loud engine from outside. She looks out the window to see Kiff in a tough black leather jacket on a mean-looking hover cycle. He beckons to her bad boy style.
At number 12, it's Wailing Fungus with Shut Up and Love Me.
Cut to a deserted highway. A heavy metal drum intro gives way to a touching melody as Kip and Amy ride off happily into the sunset. That's the Futurama cast. What a cast we have here.
Fantastic. Well done. We have time for some Q&A if you guys want. So there's a roving microphone. If you have a question, you may ask it. But I want to ask David, so what is it you think about Futurama that it just is able to... Because I feel like it's not the end. I feel like this is going to lead to more. There has to be more Futurama somewhere. The show is legitimately unkillable. It is legitimately unkillable.
You know... You shouldn't say that, because every time I truly give up hope, that's when the show comes back.
Where are you now?
Stop getting our hopes up like this.
So are you feeling hopeless about it, or are you feeling good about it?
I prefer to feel very hopeless about
very,
it.
Very, very hopeless.
No, it's a few things. But obviously, number one, the extreme hardcore fans the show has always had, who, even when the show goes off the air, refuse to stop watching it on streaming or cable or in video games, hopefully. So that's number one. And number two, I think just writing about the future, the show doesn't age quite as much as other shows. So, you know, if you write a show written 10 years ago about the future, it's still, you know, it's still 993 years in the future,
right,
or whatever. So we got a little longer before it becomes hard to watch it.
Do you want to talk about some of the guests? There's certain guests in the game that you alluded to one. Can you mention any other ones?
Yeah, is this a secret, or am I allowed to talk about that? Any Tiny Co people?
That's probably
whatever.
Fine.
Well,
here's
the ones we have so far. It's a pretty nerdy list. I mean, really just blowing it out the window right to start. Chris Hardwick.
What?
George.
They don't care about anyone else. No, I'm kidding.
George Takei, as you may have guessed.
The real one.
These are guest stars in the game, by the way, not just the show. Stephen Hawking. Back in the
Are you sure it's
Bill Nye, yeah, the science guy, and Neil deGrasse Tyson.
Wow. Yeah.
That's a group of guest stars you would not have in your average comedy show.
Yeah. I totally don't belong in that group. Let's take some questions from the audience. You guys, if there's a microphone roaming around, if you have a Futurama question, this would be an excellent time to ask it. Where's the microphone? Oh, right here. This is the microphone. Don't be shy and from Los Angeles.
This is a question for Katie.
Sorry. Not one question.
See, this is the problem with Futurama fans. They already know everything.
They already know everything, yeah.
You're going to hate yourself if you don't.
Oh, you're going to make this poor guy run all the way back there. Well, you got to do it. That's what happens.
Just yell it out. We can hear you fine. What?
Not a chance. Hey, Robin, I just farted.
No, wait. You got to talk a little bit about your George Takei, since we're on the subject.
You know...
Because that did start on the Howard Stern show,
I started it, and I started going, oh my. And then George Takei actually started coming in, and Howard was going, like, what happened to oh my? You know, because he just...
You're like, that's actually Billy.
Yeah. So he did it, and it sort of sounded the same. Oh my. I own a bank.
I'm curious, just because everyone, I mean, these are like some of the best people in the voiceover industry.
You guys
I always
know Billy
think
West was also
voiceover. You know, I always feel like maybe voiceover artists don't get the respect that they deserve, because they are literally creating all of the character with their vocalization, and they bring it to life, you know? And so you guys, you've all worked on a million different things, but just if anyone has an idea, like, what is it about Futurama in particular that is just so, that's so special? Like, there's something extra special about Futurama and the grouping of all of you. So can anyone speak to what you think that might be?
I think it has to do with the fact that it takes place in New York, in New York, and anything can kind of happen there.
You know, there's such a wide open universe just in New York itself.
Yeah.
So I think that anything kind of goes too. So yeah, New York.
Well, I think there's also something about, I mean, my experience, the biggest fandoms and the deepest fandoms are sci-fi and animation.
Yeah.
And this is like the nexus.
Yeah.
Plus the fact that, I mean, the writing I was gonna is say that. So well, good.
We have the best writing.
The writing is the best.
Best scripts. They're funny, they're geeky, they're sciency, and they're full of heart, and they mean something, and they go somewhere.
And they have the best math jokes.
Yeah. I think that makes it just the greatest pleasure to work on the show. Plus, we've become a family, you know, the eight of us. It's amazing. It's a great feeling to just...
You actually had scientists, mathematicians consult on the show. Is that correct?
Well, we didn't need consultants.
No, the writers.
That's so offensive. I have a master's degree in computer science, which put me deep in the middle of the pack of the Futurama writing staff. We had Ken Keeler, I mentioned before, PhD in applied math. Bill Odenkirk might be here, PhD in chemistry. We had Stuart Burns, master's in math. What was that?
What was Kaplan?
Philosophy.
Kaplan just got, Futurama writer Eric Kaplan, who may be here, left graduate school to write for TV, wrote for Futurama for years, been writing for The Big Bang Theory for years. He just, after however many years, finished his PhD last week, I think.
Wow.
So Dr. Kaplan.
What were the ratings?
Dr. Kaplan.
Jeff Westbrook, PhD in computer science.
Damn.
Patrick Verone has a measly law degree, but that helps once in a while. So, yeah.
Didn't you guys used to have a math club and just get together and solve problems once a week? I heard that.
We did. What about it?
Yeah. So
what of it?
No, didn't Ken Keeler create a theorem to solve the body swapping episode?
Well, that was, you see, I wish, if Ken wants to come up here, he's welcome. I'll start explaining it, and if Ken wishes to come up here, he may.
Ken can shout from the audience if he feels like it.
We did an episode where the characters all switched brains in classic cartoon fashion, so we wanted to science it up a little bit, so... We made it a little more complicated. We said, well, if any two people ever switched brains, they could not switch back. So you had to get your brain back through a series of other people. And then the more we started talking about it, we were saying, oh, wait a second. Once they get mixed up, maybe you can't even get your own brain back. So we got to the end of a day of writing, and we didn't even know the answer to that question. And then we came in the next morning, and Ken Keeler came and said, I proved a theorem. So he had proved that no matter how mixed up the brains get, if you bring in two new suckers from outside the group, then everybody, including those two people, can get their brains back by a series of switch. So I thought, like, well, this, we have an opportunity that most shows don't get. We're going to have a theorem appear on screen at the climactic moment of the episode. So we did. At the moment that the professor, in cooperation with the basketball-playing mathematicians, the Harlem Globetrotters.
That's right.
They worked it out. They put this actual theorem, the actual proof of the theorem, on this hovering chalkboard, and we showed it for a full half second, I believe. And then we cut away, but for the people who appreciate it, you can freeze frame on that.
Oh, wow.
The only sitcom to ever do that, except for one episode of Sanford and Son.
Esther, you're so ugly, I'll put your face in dough and make Gorilla cookies.
I'm so sorry I suggested that you had outside help, but I'm glad that in doing that you were able to drop your nerd dong on the table in front of everyone and explain.
That's my new punk band too. That's my new punk band, David X. Cohen's Nerd Dong. Perfect.
That's what people used to call me, but it wasn't a compliment.
But even now. Even just the detail, is it true that the glyphs, the language in the background that appears, I read that people would start solving what they thought it was and then you guys would shift the language. Is that true?
We had an alien language in the show that was, it was a simple code where you just substitute this shape means A, this shape means B. So we put it on, we're like, we'll see if the fans can figure out. We gave them like a sign that translated five random letters for them, and we didn't give them any other ones. So we thought, we'll lurk on the internet, see if they get it. So, of course, 45 minutes later, they got it. We're going to do a second, much harder language, which our computer scientist in-house, Jeff Westbrook, our in-house computer scientist, wrote a program to generate a much harder code. That one took them several days. But we put that in periodically, including one time when we even made a mistake in coding it, so that got the fans really mad. For you game players out there who are also math nerds, the game actually has an incredibly hard alien language thing in it that's not even part of the game, really. It's just it's a side puzzle for you if you want to devote an extra month to playing it. And there will be a very serious language challenge for you guys.
Excellent.
Okay.
Simple cryptography.
First mobile game with extra credit.
This game's great. There's so much homework. Why do we have to do a quiz? Yes, there's a question up front. Where's the roving microphone? Oh, you can. Yeah. I'm sorry. I don't understand how spaces work.
Oh, she's right there.
Where's the microphone? I can't hear it. It's right here. I'm sorry. So just for the internet, for people watching on Facebook, she asked, basically, was there anything going on in the current social climate that they want to be able to talk about? Was that
any new heads in jars?
Yes.
I'll tell you one thing. The Futurama mobile game is a wonderful game. It's a great game. You should get this game. It's a really good game. It's fabulous. It's wonderful. I know the robot very well. The robot's he's a good friend of mine. The robot is.
You guys know Billy West. Billy West happened to notice, to the internet's great delight, that we have a Futurama character who sounds quite a bit like our current president, both in his voice and his attitude. You've heard of Trump Brannigan, perhaps?
I pay my wife $1 a year and all the dresses she can buy.
Nicely done. There was another question. Oh yeah, so many now. Now you guys, Jordan, right there.
I want to know who everyone's favorite minor character is. Mine is Hedonism Bot.
Ooh, my. Yeah. Fetch the chocolate sauce.
Yeah, we go down the line, Johnny.
I'm a huge Zoidberg fan.
Zoidberg's not
Why
a minor
not Zoidberg?
Character.
He but he's not really way second there.
Minor character.
Minor. I love Roberto.
Oh, God.
I love Roberto.
Yeah.
One time Dave was in Austin, Texas, and for a table read, it was just the phone in the middle of the table and a speakerphone, and he was on the speakerphone, and he went, ha-ha, on the speakerphone, and it killed in the room. It was unbelievable.
And isn't that sound, like, it's basically, it's a dough. Because didn't you guys write stabbing noise?
Yeah, that was, you know, there a lot of these characters who people may name right now, these side characters, the reason they exist is because we wrote in some random thing like, you know, crazy criminal number 4, and then, but one of these geniuses does something so crazy at the table read that we say, like, that guy's coming back. And that's when he earns a name, like Roberto, at that point.
Well, John took mine, and mine was Roberto, too. I think he could have his own spin-off.
How about Inez Wong?
Well, she's all right. I like her. She's my grandma.
What's the story of Inez, by the way?
She's tough. That's why I'm channeling my grandma.
Yeah, I was going to say, is it your grandma?
Yeah, but she used to, you know, the basic Chinese phrases that I'm saying were things that my grandma always said to me, which translate as, you know, dasen ne, I'm going to beat you to death. And then jam ne gao, which means I'm going to chop your head off. All those lovely things that your parents always say to you. I like her. But Roberto, did you see that tweet that was like the original design for the fidget? It does. It looks exactly like a fidget.
Roberto is the future of the fidget
spinner.
That's
right. Yeah. And then my other one is Scruffy. So Dave Herman to me kills it.
Yes.
And you're allowed to name someone you do so we can hear the voice,
too. I love Hattie. Of Tress's old lady in the house.
Yeah, the whatchamacallit, Sarah. That's the thingamajigger in my voice that I think is so attractive.
I love Judge Whitey.
Judge Whitey.
He's just like this evil Jim Backus.
Yeah. I mean, but it's a lot of, like, Gross Point in there and other wealthy communities.
Well, it's those people that are so inbred that the words don't even come out of their mouths.
Oh, here comes another squeegee guy. what a day I've had.
I tell you who I like. I like Don Bond. And his henchman, Clamps.
That's very nice of you to say. Here's a little something for your trouble. It's money.
I love that. That's my favorite line.
I'll give you the Clamps. Clamp, clamp, and dance.
How about, I think the Hyper Chicken's pretty great. Maybe a simple hyper chicken from a backwoods asteroid. What was the line?
I'm sorry, what?
The hyper chicken.
Hyper chicken.
Yeah, the hyper chicken.
Oh. I may be a simple country hyper chicken, but I know when we're finger licked.
You know, Al Gore.
I wasn't at the record there, but it cracks me up. Al Gore was doing anything having to do with, like, oh, I'm falling through space. It continually cracks me up.
He was on like four times. Yeah. He's bordering on being a supporting character.
Not a minor character then, all right.
But a very good supporting
character.
I introduced myself to Al Gore. I was like, Mr. Vice President, it's really nice to meet you. I'm John DiMaggio. I play Bender. He went, I know you.
I like that.
I think we have time for one more question, and then we're gonna. Who should it be? I feel like this side of the room over there. Yeah, right there. Hand the microphone to that.
I was gonna do my favorite.
Billy.
Other character.
Sure.
Enos.
This is Fry's great uncle or something.
Hey, Fry, did you ever get the feeling you was going out with girls because you're supposed to? What?
Yes.
And you guys may not know about this specifically, but back to the game, I love just the amount of animation we've already seen, the guests that we've already had that got released just earlier today. I'm hoping that in the events that we have going forward, are you guys going to keep being involved in increasingly episodes of stuff that's coming out outside of just the really great in-game quotes that we've already got from everybody? But I'd love to see as much of you guys as possible going forward into as many, to make sure that it's not just one record and done, but months and years into the future, if you guys are going to keep getting these little mini episodes in this game. Is that something that you guys are already doing?
I think
doing?
The game people will speak more to that, but I believe that is the plan. So people have to keep playing, and we'll keep doing it.
That is actually a perfect transition, because we would not be here tonight without this game that is being produced. And I have the CEO of Jam City. His name is Chris DeWolf, and you should give him a huge hand, because this is why we were all able to assemble tonight. So thank you so much, Chris.
Well, I feel like I'm killing the party here. You guys are so awesome. Thank you all for coming here. We're so proud. Jam City and Tiny Co. We're so proud about this game and preserving the legacy of the Futurama brand. We hope that it lasts for years and years. It was a big challenge, actually, taking such an iconic brand from one format, television, and transforming that into what we think is going to be one of the best mobile games ever. And we couldn't have done it without the amazing partners that we have. I also want to say that it launches June 29th, so download it June 29th. And I want to give a special thanks out to our partners that helped us on this. Matt Groening. Right down there. Small fact, you went to the same high school that I did randomly in Portland, Oregon.
Oh.
Go Cards. David X. Cohen.
Yeah!
Yeah! David X. Cohen!
Who just committed to working with us for the next couple years to make this game awesome. We all heard it. We love it. Of course, Rough Draft Studios. The hilarious and unforgettable cast and crew that just made us laugh for the last night. And our great friends at Fox, who this is our fourth project with. Thank you, Fox. So now with all of this, we have a special treat for you. Before we say bye, it is the latest animation called Science Heads, and it's also the trailer for this new game. So why don't you guys go ahead and roll it?
Hi, I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson's head, and I'm here to present the new game, Futurama Worlds of Tomorrow, because I'm the spokesman for anything with even the remotest connection to science.
I beg to differ, sir. Having anything to do with science is my department.
Bill? Bill Nye?
The science guy. It's right there in my name. Now put up your dukes.
I no longer have dukes.
Quiet, both of you. You guys were never even on Futurama. I was on three times.
Only three times? And you call yourself a cartoon voice actor?
Not usually.
I was on Futurama five times, which is more than three.
I'll have to check that.
George Takei here for Futurama Worlds of Tomorrow, the fabulous new game featuring me, five-time Futurama guest star George Takei. And cut.
Hey, you stole my line, Takei.
You mean my line? Take this.
Experience the world of tomorrow today in Futurama, Worlds of Tomorrow. Available June 29th, wherever you download apps and stuff.
So I'll say it one more time, June 29th, the App Store, Google Play. Thank you guys all so much for coming here. Enjoy yourself the rest of the night.